This is Infection, the survival podcast, recorded live on Tuesday, March 28th, 2017, episode 115. Hello, everyone, and welcome to another edition of Infection, the survival podcast. Infection is your source for the latest information on survival video games. We bring you the latest news, reviews, updates, and more each and every week. My name is Nick Craig at Nicholas M. Craig is my Twitter. InfectionPodcast.com is our website. Joining me with a bit of a delay, Brian with an eye, Aldridge. Hey, Brian.
Hey, how you doing? If you want to find me at Boise Computer on Twitter, you're more than welcome to go check out my blog, biteoftech.com. Also, if you haven't gone and joined our Discord, joined our Steam group, one thing we never promote, but is to, if you don't follow us on your podcast app, please go and at least add us on there. I don't know if it really makes a difference, but at least we'll know, you know, that you did it. Because a lot of people, they just get so used to getting in kind of a groove with everything. They don't realize, oh, I've not followed them on Twitter. You know, I've not followed them on Twitch. So all those different places, if you could follow us, and it kind of gives us a guide of, you know, how many people are listening, because it's really difficult in the podcast world to really know what your numbers are. So if you haven't done that. Another thing is for our game of the week. Do we want to jump into that?
Yes, this is actually timely.
Do it early. Yes, so you have to do it today.
Yes, and while you're talking about it, I'm actually going to put a tweet out. And tell everybody.
Yeah. So what we're going to be doing is Chivalry Medieval Warfare, and it's free today. So hopefully you'll listen to this. Hopefully you're watching, but we're going to do this for a game of the week. A lot of people may already have it. I already had it, but that doesn't really say anything because I have a lot of stuff, crazy things.
I owned it.
Nick owned it, so you might have it too.
I have less than 100 games on Steam, so.
We'll have a link in there that you can go ahead and click, and today you can go redeem it. It's like purchasing the game, but it's free. So if you go and check tomorrow, I would assume, I don't know what time zones they're dealing with this on, but if you go and check tomorrow, it might cost you some money. So I would encourage you to go get the game, even if you're not sure if you're going to be there for Friday. Just go get the game so you have it in your library. Nick keeps telling me about how fun the game is. I own it. I think I downloaded it once, but I think I've deleted it since. Man. I don't think I've ever launched it.
It's a lot of fun. It's chivalry, and I mean, what you get it, you swing swords, you shoot bows, but everything, it's kind of like Dark Souls-y, where everything is really drawn out. So, you know, to swing the sword all the way around is this huge like wind up animation, and you're swinging, the other guy's swinging, he
it's
hits you
realistic.
First
it's not people's
yeah exactly it's not it's a lot of fun I would it, with our group it's probably going to be it's gonna be probably very ragey so we'll we'll see what happens, but you can download that on Steam. It is free.
There's some people are saying they think it ended already, which is kind of weird.
I don't think it already ended, but
what time are they? Time zone are they on?
It was free earlier this afternoon, so whatever. We're doing Chivalry, so I know a whole bunch of people redeemed it this morning.
We announced it, so we'll see. If we get there and like nobody has it, then we'll
find something else.
Probably play Battlegrounds.
But expect to play this.
Yeah, we'll plan on playing this. Hopefully, we got enough to do it. If not, we'll fall back on something else. So, and then also during the show, should I give away a copy of the Lawbreakers beta during one of our giveaways as well?
Yeah.
So I got the Lawbreakers beta key, and I haven't redeemed it. So, you know, I'd be perfectly happy to give that away. Maybe we'll do that as an extra giveaway. The first person, maybe have them choose between the game of the week or Lawbreakers beta, and then we'll do a second drawing. So very good. So if you haven't followed us on Discord, which is a great way if you're playing games, a lot of people playing Battlegrounds this week, it's a really good way to connect with people, get groups going. We've had, you know, three groups going at a time for Battleground, three, four-man groups. So if you're looking for people to play with, I really encourage you to go to our Discord. If you go to infectionpodcast.com on the right-hand side, it's got a link there that just says join. It shows a list of our channels, people that are in there at one time. You know, there's over 50-something people in there right now. So a lot of people with a lot of different games. So I would encourage you to go in there because we have a really good community of people that are ready to play a lot of the latest games, even some old games. Also our Steam group. So we give nice notifications right before the show starts, when the Friday night game night starts. So we have a Steam group. It's on the right-hand side of the website as well. You click join the Steam group and, you know, you'll need to join it once and you'll just get notifications. I think you probably can turn off notifications in there if it gets too much of a hassle, but it's a good way. So if you're joining up with other people, you can see them on your friends list through that. So it's a good way to connect up with other people, see what people that are maybe playing the same game that you are.
Yes, for sure.
I think that's all the self-promotion I got.
All the self-promotion. I had an interesting week. I don't want to delve into it too much, but after the show last week, I flew down to North Carolina for some work. So I actually have played like two games of Battlegrounds since it came out.
Yeah, because you got here and pretty much installed it, what, yesterday?
I installed it last night, yeah, and played two or three quick duo games. So that I unfortunately did not have a whole lot of time to play Battlegrounds, but I know for a fact, Brian, you did. So let's just jump into this first. Let us know what happened. How was it? Was it different?
Okay, so I mean, it's very similar to the test. I mean, they haven't changed dramatically, but that's one thing with this, that the queuing system's been working really well. They had a few hiccups here and there on launch of the servers crashing out. They got them up within a reasonable amount of time, but not a huge problem. So with this, it's been a very smooth launch. For the number of players, it's kind of been interesting to watch the King of the Kill numbers and the numbers here. And if you look on Twitch now, I mean, these guys are just on the top of Twitch for days straight now. You always figure kind of maybe day one.
Yeah.
They would be there. But they've maintained that position on Twitch of being in the top, three. Earlier today, they were ahead of League of Legends, which is a big deal. I mean, that's a tough one to to get to second place, but they've been doing really well. So
there it is right now. League of Legends is topping Twitch right now with 82,000 viewers. IRL's at 58, it's probably just one person, and then Battlegrounds in a solid third place with 45,000, Hearthstone behind that, followed by Street Fighter and Counter-Strike. Overwatch, Destiny, World of Warcraft, Dota 2, Dark Souls, and Kingdom Hearts HD has actually got 14,000 viewers right now on Twitch.
It's got to be one streamer.
It's one streamer for sure.
So where's H1Z1 on that list?
H1Z1 is got 8,000 people watching it. But it's interesting you say that, Brian, because the big H1Z1 streamers, Summit, Dr. Disrespect, Lyric, those. And I'm sure I'm missing people for sure, but those group of people, or I should say that group of people, and those other rounds of people like Manpawns or whatever, are all playing Battlegrounds. Part of that, actually, Manpawns is actually streaming H1Z1, which is pretty surprising. But, right now is not really a fair assessment to say, nobody's streaming H1Z1, because, everybody in the right mind.
The big streamers are, but. It depends how much they can cater. So here's the question. How long will they maintain, or will they be able to continue to maintain the attention of these streamers? And I personally think if they can continue to keep the numbers up as far as putting out patches, if they see a bug, patching it right away.
Well, hold on, though.
Get the movement.
But hold on. You're what kind of patch can this game put out? What they're not going to put out content patches. This isn't an arc. This isn't a.
No, I'm talking about like as far as movement. Like that's one thing that they're starting to work on now is really nail down the movement. So they're going to make it to where you can vault over walls, just get it to where it feels like a seamless experience when you're moving. Because I think that's its biggest drawback right now, are just kind of the weird glitchy movement mechanics that they have. So when you're running and you jump. Right now, it jumps in a straight line. You can't jump and kind of go to the left. It doesn't change. It has to. It forces that animation all the way through the jump sequence. The same thing with there's just certain things that you get locked into, and I switched back and forth the test. Like, I played Battlegrounds for a while, and then I went and played one game of H1Z1. And the biggest difference I saw is that H1Z1 doesn't have any kind of realistic movements. Like, if you're going right, you can immediately go left, which they run into the problem of people spamming crouch, spamming left, right, is because it's not a realistic movement. It makes it to where it's a pain to play against people that maybe have put a macro into their mouse, a mouse key or something, or on their keyboard, to where they can do these crazy movements that they programmed in beforehand.
Yeah.
You can't do that with this. Like, if you're going to the right, like, you have to slow down and stop, and then you can move to the left. So I don't know how much I want them to really smooth it out. But, you know, I think they could do a lot with the jumping mechanics. And, you know, there's just, they just haven't finished that part yet. And when you're running up to a wall, like, you have to get it just right. Like, you have to get a running sprint and then just catch the wall just right to jump over it. They're going to make it so you can go up to a wall and actually, you know, step over it.
Yeah.
So I think if they do that, the game will feel much smoother. The gunplay is great. You know, the sounds they're still working on, like, especially when people are following you, you know, after they've died and they're observing you, they really need to work on the audio. Cause I think it's based on, like, the direction you were facing you when you died or something.
It's based on your character. Exactly. Yeah.
Yeah. So that gets all messed up. So maybe someone is watching you and they're like, oh, there's a shot to your left, and it totally throws you off. Cause really it's totally some other direction to you. So that's all stuff that this is what, week one.
Game came out last Thursday. I mean, so not even week one's not even over yet.
I mean, I can't really give them a tough time yet. Like, I remember I gave H1Z1 a lot of slack in the beginning.
Yep.
And I gave them slack for, I think, a year, if I remember correctly.
And then I slowly corrupted you.
And then you corrupted me, you know, and so.
Now you're a terrible person.
Sorry. I like to give the benefit of the doubt as long as possible.
People are too harsh.
Yeah, I want to give them the benefit of the doubt until someone proves you wrong. And if they can continue, that's what I was saying, if they can continue to put out patches, put out updates, I think that, PH is saying, you know, I don't know how much that is going to change. They're going for the ARMA movement. I don't think so. I think they were more limited by the ARMA movement. ARMA, there's not much that you can do to get around the engine of it. Like, it's a mod. And so you're kind of limited to some of the mechanics that are pre-built into that game. I don't think that that's, I think they're wanting it to feel somewhat similar, but they have the ability to make it as smooth or as not smooth as they feel like. And so I think they're going to go for probably even a little bit more of a natural experience than what ARMA does. So, but we'll have to, you know, we'll have to see.
Yeah. Now, one thing I did note, they seem to have broken the parachutes again when you're landing. It takes your player kind of squats probably 20 feet before hitting the ground, and it's a very slow descent. You feel
so
like
it goes to like
eternity.
20 kilometers per hour, right when you get to the end.
Yeah.
Even if you're facing down, I think before they had it to where if you're facing directly down, it would go up to 60, if I remember correctly. So, but I think you can get a little bit closer to the ground before it does that. So I think they're still tweaking when that kicks in, how fast you can go. I mean, there is a little bit of strategy to it. But
yeah, but there's the difference
they
between
could definitely speed up that last 10, you know, 5 seconds.
That,
seconds.
And that's what it is. It's the last 10 seconds or the last 5 seconds or so that you're just sitting there and your character is just slowly descending to, you know, before their feet get on the ground. Yeah. And don't give me this it's not realistic. It doesn't matter if it's realistic, all right? I don't need to sit in a parachute for 10 extra seconds while my character goes to the ground. BS point, and it's just irrelevant.
Let's discuss this a minute, because here's the danger of getting what you want. Because we ran into this with H1Z1. When everybody gets what they want, look what you end up with.
Yeah.
Right? So how much do we want to let that go? Because the second they start doing that to try to make it a little bit faster paced game so that the streamers, you know, because that's the thing that'll kill streamers is having that slow pace.
Well, but hold on a second, because I think you're making an unfair assessment here. This, it was perfectly fine in the beta weekend before. I'm not saying, hey guys, here's this new feature, incorporate this because the community says so.
I'm just saying this, that's one thing, but I think they really got to balance it, you know. And I think I agree with you that it needs to be faster, but how many things like that are they going to change to make it faster until it turns into just an arcade-y shooter?
Well,
because that's what happened with H1Z1. It kind of started out like this.
Well, it didn't. I don't see why. What was the benefit of adding that delay? I mean, that's all they're doing is they're adding a buffer before you hit the ground. If it was like that the entire time, there probably wouldn't be anything to complain about. But for three beta tests in a row, that wasn't there. So why is it there now?
I'll bet you they'll double that to maybe 40. I think they felt like 60 was too fast. I bet you they'll knock it down to about 40, and that'll probably be 40 kilometers per hour at the end.
And
that'll feel like a natural landing speed.
And that's my frustration with it. It's not that it's too slow. It's that it's, for three tests, it was perfectly fine.
Yeah.
You can cut the cables and skip that part, but that would have been nice to be in part of the
You can skip that part and then take a three quarters damage.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, I just don't understand why they would have changed that now. Just seems like a stupid thing to change literally the day your game comes out. Here's the good thing, Brian. If that's your only complaint, you got a pretty damn good game on your hands, right? Like, if that's the only thing you have to complain about is, your parachute's a little slow, it takes me longer to go to a house and get a gun. If that's my only complaint, they're in really good shape.
Yep.
And they are in really good shape. I mean, let's be realistic with it. They are in really good shape right now.
So this is one thing of this game. Personally, I feel like it's better in groups. I see people, and this is something that probably Dr. Disrespect is going to have to figure out, is this game is kind of made it, like, I personally find it much more enjoyable in groups. H1Z1 I can handle solo more.
Yes.
But this, and now that H1Z1's a little bit faster, back when you would sit and wait for 15 minutes, it was unbearable. But I think now it's better. This game, maybe if they can have tweaks to the solo game to maybe make it a little bit faster, that would be one thing. But I think for group games, it's perfect as far as timing.
Yeah.
You know, they could make, I don't know how you could really, there are lulls, but with that big of a map, how are you not going to have lulls in the middle at some point?
Yeah.
There's going to be a point when you're running around and doing a little bit of a running simulator. I don't think you're going to get around that.
And I think, as I've said since the beginning, it's all about how familiar and how comfortable you are with the game, with the map, with the controls. And once, like we are, and I say we, I mean Brian, myself, and most of the members in our group, we are very comfortable with H1Z1. We know the map like the back of our hand. We're very comfortable with it. Once you feel that same way about Battlegrounds, the game will get much quicker.
Yeah.
So that's part of the newness
factor. You'll go to this one place and be like, oh, we just have this amount of time. A lot of people are misjudging the gas. Like, they're taking too much time, thinking they have plenty of time.
Yeah, but see, Brian, you're saying that you were one of those people in H1Z1 would miscalculate yourself and kill our group.
But that's the thing. But that's something with this that's a big difference. Like, you can't get ahead of it.
Yeah. And this is perfect for me because I'm always early out of the gas, so I'm not having any problem with it. But exactly what you're talking about is definitely the real deal. That gas comes up on you quick, but again, part of that is the newness. It takes quite a while to go through and search through houses because you're not, you know, you're still looking at ammo. You're still looking at gun. Hey, which gun is better? Do I want the UMP or do I want the AKM or the M16? You know, you're still having that argument.
I think there's more randomness to this loot than we had early on in H1Z1. Because in H1Z1, you knew, okay, if I land in these three houses, I'm going to find an AR in one of those three, four houses. Like, that's just how it is. If I don't find an AR in the first 10 seconds, I'm pissed, right? That's how that game has turned into. Versus this, there's a lot more strategy of where you land. There's a lot more area to land at, and you're not guaranteed to have multiple groups in front of you, and you have enough time to adjust. H1Z1, pretty much you're landing where you happen to be parachuting over in the beginning.
Oh, for sure.
I mean, with this, that's the big difference. You choose when you get a jump. H1Z1's more of a random number generation. The server's pretty much picking, oh, you happen to be above this one spot that has loot. You have a group of four people. What do? So you don't have the choices. Here you do. And so there's a lot more strategy involved with where you're going. Now, Donnie PC, he's bringing up that they're going to be adding ballistics, which is going to make a big difference.
Yeah.
Because
explain what that is.
Okay. So right now the bullets, when they fire, they don't drop. So if you have your sights on somebody, you're going to hit them in the head. Like, you just have to line up the shot. They're putting in bullet ballistics to where you'll have that drop off. So it won't be just okay, I see that guy, I'm just going to start shooting. You actually have to measure how much drop, the distance that you have between the person, and they had it during the test. So you're probably used to it.
Yeah.
During the test, they had it to where you had to measure your sight, but they turned that off for this because I think they're still working on it, trying to get it right. They probably don't want people getting used to the wrong, used to it with the bullet drop and then saying, oh, you changed it. So they're just having it to where pretty much you put your sights on them and you shoot them from any distance. But this game is going to get a lot harder. Guns will matter a lot more when the actual distance that gun is able to fire is dependent on whether you hit somebody. Because right now you could take an Uzi, and as long as you put the sight on them, you're going to hit them from whatever distance. At some point, it's going to make a big difference because an Uzi is not going to go that distance. An AR may not go that distance. And the sniper rifle will make a big difference because it'll be the only one that will be able to cross that distance to hit somebody. So I think that'll make a huge difference, and it'll totally change the play style of how it feels once you have that bullet drop in there.
I mean,
it will be normal, like a real gun.
It'll make it more like Battlefield, which is Battlefield. I think Battlefield is the golden standard when it comes to a game with bullet ballistics and a game with bullet drop. I mean, that's what it comes down to. Battlefield's got that. I think they've got it down pretty pat.
And I think it's going to make the good streamers stand out even more, because those are the guys that sit there and play it for 8 hours a day, and they learn the perfect amount of drop, and they really learn how to do it. Because right now, as long as you can point, the target, your reticle on the target, you'll hit them. I think once you have some of the pros, which is what they pretty much are, that are going in there and doing ridiculous shots, like, that'll be the stuff that you'll see clipped and on YouTube, is people doing crazy shots that are really difficult to do.
Yeah. I don't know how I feel about them turning that bullet drop stuff off. Again, it was in 3 tests. Why would you decide to turn it off now?
Well, okay, so
it's just
me to give you a little speculation of why I think?
I mean, Brian, it's in our intro.
speculation. So personally, I think they changed how the bullets are. I'm thinking that now what they're doing is just doing a detection of what's on the other side of where you're pointing, and not actually sending an object through the world and hitting something, because that spawns in assets. And so if you have a lot of people shooting, it'll cause server lag, it'll cause frame drops. And so I'm personally thinking that, as Tag is saying, probably to ease the server load, I think they temporarily changed it to where when you fire at somebody, all it's doing is saying, all right, what's on the other end of where I'm pointing? Oh, it's a person. All right, put damage on them. Rather than the way that ballistics works, of actually having an object that has physics attached to it, that, the engine is actually calculating and doing the drop for you. So I personally think that, not that I've seen them say that, but I personally think they're doing it so that they would have a smooth launch and would be able to figure out some of the server load and stability first before they start throwing thousands of bullets into the world.
Now, let me ask you, when did you get this game? Did you get it Thursday?
Yeah, I got it launch day.
What was it like?
It was pretty good. Just minimal, here and there.
Typical launch day stuff?
Yeah, I mean, 100-something thousand people are playing or whatever type of issue.
Okay, yeah.
But that's something that it pretty much settled itself out. They've done a really good job, much better. I mean, if you remember the first days of H1Z1, just to kind of compare, we couldn't play it for the first how many hours?
It was probably the first 8 hours or so.
That it was down. So, these guys did a very good job. They're using Amazon web servers so they can spin up additional servers. As PH is saying, the cloud, they don't have those issues. They can pretty much spin up instances of servers. The more people they get, spin them down when they're done. I think that, they've got it. Like, they made it as smooth as you possibly could have for the amount of sales. Now, do we want to go into the number of sales?
Yes. Yeah, so this is quite astonishing. This article, I think I first saw, I saw it on Twitter or something like that, but Bluehole, who is actually, let's explain this, because this might be a little confusing to people. Player Unknown developed the mod, the Arma mod that was called Battle Royale. That's what I was looking for. He developed Battle Royale for Arma, and then in turn sold that to IDEA and the concept of the game to H1Z1. They have then changed the name.
Well, he licensed it to them.
Licensed it to them. They then changed the name to King of the Kill. And now with Battlegrounds, he is not developing the game. The company Bluehole, which is a Korean development company, I believe, came to him and said, hey.
They actually approached him.
Like, hey, we want to make your game.
We want to make your game. And Bluehole, like, this isn't the first game. They make, like, Terra. They've made some other games that you would know about. And they said they must have seen
the potential.
Just the mess. Well, they probably saw the mess that Daybreak was making of his concept, of just the development mess, and said, well, we can make that and we can make it right. I'm kind of guessing, because probably when they took away the name, Player Unknown's Battle Royale from the King of the Kill matches, they knew. And so they approached him, and obviously this was a really good bet on their part, because if you look at the numbers, that $11 million in the first 3 days. So, they had over 67,000 concurrent. I think they went higher than that. I thought they had 100,000+.
No, they didn't. They didn't break 100,000.
But
we'll cover those numbers.
That's right. That was the on Twitch.
But we'll cover those numbers later on the show, Brian. Don't worry. Wink, wink. Yes. We'll have those. Well, finally, current players, which we've missed for the past 2 weeks, we'll actually we'll cover exactly those numbers.
Actually say it.
Yeah, I'm still sick, but different. My voice isn't as bad. Hopefully,
it's been going around. I actually had someone from my school was saying they've had a lot of students that have had this ongoing, like, just getting sick again, one right after another.
Yeah, the lack of sleep over the past week, because of the work I was doing, was not helpful. Right as I was starting to get better, I was sleeping 4 hours a night, and then, four airplanes later. The time zone, well, not the time zone, the airplanes and the whole thing. Nevertheless, current players will return. Green Man is pumped, and so am I. So, 11 million sales.
You want to go into the patch day notes? So, because you knew what would happen before. Like, that was your experience with it. So, do you want me to tell you what changed from then to what you're playing now?
Yes, learn me. What's going on?
All right, so characters may seem like they are shaking when in spectate mode. So these are known issues. So these are things they're admitting on launch day that they had. I'm sure they're working on them right now. For non-English users, some of the in-game text may still show in English. They haven't done a full translation of that yet. Collision checks on destructed doors may not be in sync with how they look. You may be able to either not get as close to a door as you think you can, or not, you're closer to than you should be. And then also certain hairstyle colors, and it's like a hair color and style combinations, will cause the overall hair to not be visible. So that's something they're fixing. And there's a bug that is causing the view distance option to not be adjustable via individual graphic settings. Since this plays an important role in the performance of the client, if you want to force this change, they give you some settings. You can go edit your game user settings.ini file, change some numbers in there, and we'll have it in the show notes to where you can check that out. And then as far as performance and stability, server stabilization and client performance improvements are consistently being worked on. Slightly improve the issue that caused massive number of players to get disconnected from a game. Destruction logic has been reworked so that the destruction of doors does not interfere with the server performance. Resolve some issues that were causing client crashes. They added the SKS rifle to the game, which is a very good sniper, kind of a rapid fire sniper rifle. Two new face presets have been added, so a new male and a female preset. They improved the parachute controls, which I think are much better than they were. They added free look when in first person view. And then you're now able to sort your items in your inventory. And then 9 other new languages have been added to the game. So they now have 12 languages in the game. You know, some may be very bad translations, but they'll be consistently adjusting those throughout early access to get them as accurate as possible. And then the exclusive items for pre-ordering the deluxe edition are now available via the in-game redeem function. So you get special shoes and jacket, some other things. Slightly adjusted the balance on end-game rewards. And then they've had some bug fixes here. So fix a bug that was causing the scoped aim to seem different than the actual when spectating. So it was actually either higher or lower than what you were, you would think that the person was missing. They fixed a bug that was causing the end game result screen to not appear when spectating and all your teammates die. That was kind of an annoying one. So that's glad they fixed that. They fixed the bug that caused the indoor footstep sounds to be low. And then they fixed a bug that caused stats from other game modes to be applied between solos, duos, and squads. So that was the early access launch day patch notes. They haven't put out another set of patch notes yet. So we'll keep an eye out for that. It'll be interesting to see how much stuff they fix. I'm sure, you know, they're right now they're making sure everything is stable and trying to keep everything working. And hopefully we'll start to see improvements here in the next week or two, because I'm sure they're working hard on it.
Yes. It's going to be interesting to see. Now, you asked me this question earlier, and I never actually gave you an answer. Or maybe I did. You asked me, how long are these streamers going to stay playing this game, right? They're going to continue playing this game until H1Z1 introduces probably, I don't know, something that draws them back.
But I don't think
that's what it comes down to.
I don't think now that H1Z1 is going to solely be able to hold the attention of the streamers anymore. I think this will be something where they're bounced back and forth to keep people interested.
I agree.
Show, but I think now for the first time, there's an alternative to King of the Kill.
Yeah, yeah.
The people won't say, oh, you're playing CSGO. You know, you'll have the people that'll be like, oh, play CSGO. Oh, I don't want to play, I don't want to watch CSGO. This is close enough. I think you'll be able to maintain and not have a bunch of people drop off your stream the second you switch games.
Yeah. So I think for a lot of streamers, you know, it's going to be something that they get frustrated enough with Battlegrounds, they'll just launch King of the Kill and start playing that. It's, if anything, for the viewer, this is probably one of the best things that could have happened, because streamers will play a game until they get frustrated with it enough to switch to the other. And they're both semi-similar games and I think have the same audience for the most part. So this is great for people that love watching
so
streamers.
I mean, I've seen like Dr. Disrespect on H1Z1 pulling 15,000, and I've seen him on this game pulling 15,000. So he's obviously not losing viewers because he's playing this game.
Exactly. So I don't know. It's I look forward to it. It's nice that both of these games will be able to be streamed in entirety. And I mean, for me personally, for our group, we weren't playing King of the Kill anyway. So to say, oh, well, you know, Battlegrounds is going to kill King of the Kill, we weren't playing it anyway. So I think that's a hard, to be honest with you, Brian, I think it's a BS claim to make, is that, oh, you know, we're not, screw H1Z1, we're going to play Battlegrounds. Well, were
we
you really
playing it
exactly?
Anymore.
Were you really playing H1Z1 beforehand? And the answer is probably no. But here's the thing: there's still hundreds of thousands of people playing King of the Kill. So,
we want to go into that?
Well, we'll see. We'll see what comes of that. But
do you want to go into that number right now?
No, I don't want to go into it right now.
Okay.
But we'll grab that in another segment. But I don't know. I mean, do you think that the streamers? Here's the thing: this game is much harder. Right, so I mean, if you suck at the game, then you're not gonna play it, right? If you're suck like me, I'm pretty bad at Battlegrounds. If I was a streamer, I'd have to play King of the Kill because I'm better at that than I am at Battlegrounds.
Yeah,
right. I mean, that's what it's gonna come down to.
But that's the thing. Okay, so like I heard, for instance, Dr. Disrespect say, I'm going to play this until of course, you know how he says it, until I'm the best.
He's never going to, he said he'd never play H1Z1 again multiple times and would come on the next day and play
H1Z1. That's
the
thing is, I think he's dedicated. He wants, and this game, there's a huge difference that right now, at least, there's not the hackers. I think for the first time in a long time, these streamers are able to play a game and they're not getting dominated by hackers. They're able to go and get consistent first place wins because of their talent, not because of some ridiculous shot. You know, there are ridiculous shots where people, where you maybe don't hear where the audio is coming from, or, you know, you're confused on that.
Yeah.
But it's not somebody coming around a corner and insta-tapping you in the head.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Like, all the shots, for the most part, seem legitimate. There's not the crazy amount of hackers in this game. And I think that they'll do a much better job of being able to control it. I think we can all agree that Daybreak has done a horrible job when it comes to controlling hackers.
For sure.
I mean, there'll be some times when it's gone down a little bit, but then it always goes back to crazy numbers. And if you look right now, if you go look at, just search for cheats and in the posts for cheats in H1Z1 in the past couple of weeks, you'll see tons of hackers. There's tons of them. I was watching, somebody had posted a link to a live stream of somebody using a cheat, and, you know, he streamed a couple of games, no issues. He was speed hacking. He was teleporting. He was, you know, aimbotting people from across the map. Nothing happened. He didn't get banned during the stream. I mean, he was able to play as many games as he felt like until he was done.
Yeah.
In this game, the complaint has been with hackers is that people are going on the hack forums and saying, I've got banned and I only did one teleport. Like, this is what Daybreak should have been doing from the beginning. And there's no reason that they're not. Like, it doesn't make sense. And we'll go into it.
And they're both using BattleEye.
Yeah. It purely comes down to, here they say, all right, if you teleport, we can detect it. You're banned. And they're not giving them warnings. And that's what they're complaining about. They're like, I didn't get my three warnings that Daybreak gives me.
Yeah.
Yeah. You don't get warnings. They ban you. If you cheat, you get banned.
And some of this has to do with the effectiveness of not rolling their own servers. The effectiveness of using something like AWS instead of having to have and manage and maintain physical hardware, physical servers, right? Physical internet connections, physical servers, and all that stuff. I mean, when they want to pull up new servers, Brian, somebody logs into an Amazon account and just spins new servers up. It's not...
Well, it's probably 100% automated.
I mean, you clone. Probably, you just clone a new server. You just clone the old one, and it just turns back on and gets an IP address, and you're good to go.
They're just spinning up additional instances, and they don't have to sit here and figure out, well, how can we squeeze this many more people? They put it at 100, which is a very fair number. It feels just fine.
More than enough,
They're not like Daybreak, oh, can we get 200 on there? We want to get 200 on this map. Should we make it so the latency, it'll give them all these things and they don't have to check with the server? Let's squeeze 200 in there. Let's make it so that the game is just a miserable pile to play for people that don't have high ping. Just for the sake of having 200 people on there. Put 100 people in King of the Kill. It'd make it a much more fun game to play. Put restrictions on it and put 100 people, just like they did here. I think... sticking it at 100 people, now they're just going to make the performance as good as possible with that 100 people, not only making server performance better so they can squeeze a few more people on there and keep kind of mediocre performance.
Yeah.
Because that's what we got with Daybreak. There was, oh, we got 160 people. I don't care if you have 160 people. Make the map a little bit smaller and, you know, and have less people on there.
Yeah.
That's your issue.
The player amount in Battlegrounds doesn't really bother me. And I think probably why is that the loot in groups is tough. If you're playing on a group of four, that you're going to three or four, maybe even five different, what would you call them? The little clusters of houses together until you're all geared out successfully. In H1Z1, you're looking at one, maybe two sets of those POIs, that points of interest. You go to maybe four or five points of interest in Battlegrounds to get what you want. And then you still may not even have what you want.
It may take you up to five houses to get an assault rifle.
Yeah.
In King of the Kill. And you're like, oh man, that took forever.
Yeah.
But in this, it's like you may loot a whole city and you're like, man, I didn't find the gun that I was wanting.
Exactly.
You know, I'm running around with an Uzi, you know, and
which,
I want to
have...
which
is a good gun, by the way. I don't care.
Well,
wait
till they put the list in there and drop. Then it'd be like, I can't hit anybody for more than, you know, 50 feet away.
And that's the point. But I mean, that's part of it, Brian, is in H1Z1. And here's the thing. I'm not trying to sit here and bash H1Z1. It's just how the game is. It's a different play style. It's a different game. In H1Z1, if you go to you go to those camps in the, those, the, camps next to the lake in H1Z1. You go there with a group of five people, you will leave there. Everybody will leave the
fully decked out.
Fully decked out.
I mean,
you go to.
I'd be very surprised. Not everybody had military backpacks. You should all have an AR or an AK.
Yeah.
You know, there will be no reason.
You'll have 400 rounds of ammo. You'll have a lot of stuff. The loot tables are much smaller in Battlegrounds. I mean, I've had it multiple times where I have to go into six or seven different houses just to find a backpack. Just the level one backpack. I can't pick anything else up. So,
I like that more though.
That's why the 100 player limit works better, because you have to venture out. You can't just stay in one little area. Now in solos you can. It's a little more conducive to that, because you can, you know, you find five houses, you'll probably find enough loot for yourself. But you won't find enough loot for four people in five or six houses. You need to go to 3, 4, 5, maybe even 6 points of interest to get what you want.
Tag's bringing up a comment. He says, I've never won a game in H1Z1, and he won a solo in less than 24 hours after launch in Battlegrounds. How much of that is because of the fact that there's probably minimal amounts of hackers? Like, how many games with 160-something people with a high percentage of hackers that are in H1Z1, how many does it take to ruin the experience of that whole group?
Well, I've got something on the flip side of, but I've got something on the flip side of that is interesting. What did we see during the last H1Z1 Invitational? What were all the players doing, Brian?
Everybody was hiding. Everybody was.
That's what happens in H1Z1. That is, now there are some people that sit in house camp in Battlegrounds, but it's far
and so spread out. Like, you don't even know that somebody's going to come across you.
Exactly. So part of the, I'm not saying that, I'm not saying that, oh, it's just definitely the hackers, but people are, I mean, you're not sitting in houses. I'm not sitting in houses. We used to do that in H1Z1, Brian. Yeah. We would sit in a bush the entire game and wait. That's what we used to do.
Wait for the gas, 15 minutes for it to get to you.
That's what we would do. That doesn't happen. I mean, that's not how I play. That's not how you play. That's not how our group plays. We don't sit in houses for.
It's one where, hey, we need to go. Okay, so here's one aspect of that. You've got the configurable weapons. You have customizable weapons that make a big difference. So it's not just, oh, I got an AK, I got an AKM, or I got an SKS. I got this gun. Now you're like, oh, I need to go and find a scope for it.
Yes, exactly.
I need to go find these attachments for it. You know, I've got one, but it makes such a big difference to where, okay, you've got a gun, but you're going to possibly lose on the distance fight because you don't have an 8X scope. You don't have a 4X scope. So that keeps you going and looking for that a little bit more. It keeps people moving around the map the whole time. And they've got the loot balance done well enough to where it's, you know, down to that last stretch, it can be like, man, I still haven't found the scope I need.
Exactly.
You know, trying to work it.
And all of that stuff adds up. Now, I'm never going to say, oh, this is the reason why Battlegrounds is this or H1Z1 is this. It's a whole mixture of things. In H1Z1, you find the AR, you got it. Now, all you need is ammo.
At that point, you could hide. You know, once you get an AR and ammo, you could hide for
the rest of the game. And that's what people do. And part of this is also the newness as well. People don't want to just sit in a house in Battlegrounds. The game is new. They want to get out. They want to explore. They want to kill people.
But so, I think that they would be at a disadvantage hiding in this game, because you wouldn't get those things that you need.
Well, here's the thing. If you're sitting in a house, do you need an 8X scope if you're sitting in a house? Do you need anything more than a shotgun if you're sitting in a house?
That's the thing, is it almost always makes you move across big open areas.
But that, exactly. But my question to you is,
you can last until that point, but you'll be at a disadvantage after you have to be forced to move.
Exactly. So I think a lot of people are at this point trying to figure out what works, what doesn't. So I would imagine if you're consistently winning games now, I would bet you in 3 months that will have changed, because the player base will be better, people will be more comfortable, and they'll be playing the game differently. That's just my opinion on it. I play the game now.
I think it'll be much more competitive.
I play the game now with a pretty much F this mentality. I don't not go anywhere. I'll run across any open field. I'll do anything. I don't care about dying, because the game is so new. I want to get experience. I want to play. It really doesn't matter. So, but that will change.
The interesting thing with this too is you can kind of pick which one you feel like. You can be like, oh, I want to land in a populated area, just like you do in H1Z1. I want to land in a populated area and get some instant action. You know, and you may come out with a couple kills, but you're probably not going to last to the end. Or you can decide, all right, we're going to go to this town on the outside, you know, and we're going to get geared up, and then we're going to go in, and you'll probably last longer, but you're not going to have as many kills. It'll be interesting to see where the streamers go. If they start once the game is not new anymore, like, all right, I'm always landing in the action, you know, and the good ones will come out on top. And so that may keep the game a fast enough pace to where it feels as fast as H1Z1, because if you land in one of those sought after areas, you know, you will get 10 kills, you know, in the first 10 minutes. If you land in those areas and you're good. But the thing is, if you land on the outside, you may get 4 kills here and there, you know, finding a group, but that's it. Like but you can pick the play style based on where you jump out of the plane. When before with H1Z1, you couldn't. Like it just happened to be where you were. You land in the closest place that has something.
Exactly. So it'll be interesting to see how that evolves. Now, the kind of the only other issue I have is sometimes the plane goes horizontally across the map and it kind of trails the river that splits the two islands. That's got to stop, because that is just the worst. Because you can't get north. I mean, you're pretty much stuck either on the north side of the island or the south side of the main island. That's it. That spawn is very annoying.
I'm sure they'll be adjusting to see. They probably have a lot of statistics.
It's a bad spawn. It's nothing more than. I don't say, oh, well, you know, close combat. It's a shitty spawn because you have this huge map and you can't get north. You're literally moving directly horizontally. No, you know, nothing is changing. So. It'll be interesting. We'll see.
It'll be interesting, and that's the thing. Over the next couple of weeks, I'll be really, really interested to see the patch notes of the kind of things that they're starting to change.
Yeah, for sure.
Because we don't really know. We saw the day one, but it'll be interesting to see once they have it fairly stable what things they're actually focusing on, and especially with these kind of numbers after launch, are we going to see them up the development team? You know, that's one thing we complain about constantly with H1Z1. It seems like they were reducing the size of their development teams. You know, they're making more skins, but they're not really working on the game is what it felt like. Here, it doesn't really, you know, you don't see anything saying, hey, we're promoting these skins. Like, they're not pushing the skins. Like, it's a big group of developers. Like, they make the game, and that's what they do. So, you know, I don't see them going, and all I would see them doing is with this successful of a game is saying, hey, we're just going to bring on more people. So that'll be interesting to see how big are they going to get. And only time will tell. Because as we've seen with a lot of these games, we can't guess.
Now, Joe is saying this game is doing skins. What are your thoughts on that? Because you've been a very harsh critic of skins in H1Z1.
So the skins are not outlandish. Like, they all kind of match in. And so this is going to really be how firm he can be with saying, all right, let's not chase the quick dollar. Let's maintain the integrity of the view of the game. And I really hope he does that. From what I've seen, they will do some kind of something that looks a little bit like Mad Max style, as far as like metal spikes and things and shoulder pads. They're going that far, but they're not doing wrestler outfits and all this stuff. So I don't mind a kind of a Mad Max renegade type of look that's still leather and realistic. Like, I want to see what would people go out, you know, into a thing like this wearing. And I can promise you they're not going to be wearing spandex with muscles on it, or, you know, a Mr. T shirt, or not Mr. T, but Hulk Hogan shirt, you know, all this stuff. Like, that's not the kind of stuff that they would go out in fighting for their lives in. And that's what always has driven me crazy with H1Z1, that I think that he's going to be able to continue to maintain. They can come up with some cool looking outfits that are sought after without going ridiculous.
Yeah.
So
and hopefully, as you said, not chase the quick dollar, you know, $11 million. This is great. You know, let's see if we can't do 10 more million on selling
let's get a bunch of 12-year-olds to buy use their mom's credit card and get a bunch of skins, which that's what Daybreak fell into. The short.
You're obsessed with. You think everybody that plays games online are 12 years old. I find that offensive because not long ago, Brian, was I a 12-year-old playing games online.
And did you borrow your mom's credit card to buy things?
I had to. Yes, I did.
Yeah, exactly.
Exactly, I did. Mom! And they realized Mom!
That the parents, to shut them up and keep them out of their faces, will give them money to say, all right, go play your game. Leave me alone. Your dad and I are going to have a drink.
No, that's
not what they'll say.
My parents were having the drinks. They were not giving me their credit card to buy whatever.
They weren't giving you money.
They weren't giving me money to go buy things online. But again, as long as, you know, I don't know. I want to say something. I don't want to get in any trouble with this, but I wonder if part of PlayerUnknown keeping this on track, the fact that he's an employee of the company making the game and doesn't actually own the game. Do you think?
No, I think he does.
Do you think he owns the game?
He owns the game. Yeah. He's just giving them a percentage probably of everything that he makes.
His card says creative director at PlayerUnknown's Battlegrounds, according to his business.
Yeah,
card.
But
I'm telling you, that's what his business card says. Do you think
that'd be something interesting? I bet he owns. I'm pretty sure he owns it. He is not. He doesn't own Blue Hole. Blue Hole is making it for Battlegrounds.
It says he is the creative director. That is not a stat. That is not a. That does not mean owning. So, I'm bringing up this point because it's important. If you know, I'm sure at Daybreak, Smedley was reaping the benefit of a game selling hundreds of thousands, millions of copies.
Yeah, but it kind of went. That's the thing with that game is it. He kind of lost control of it, and it once it sold, I don't think he was the one who went ridiculous with it. I think he probably was kind of upset that it went the way it did. And that's probably one of the reasons they fired him. You know what I'm saying? Like
that whole firing thing is still a mystery to me.
When we talked to PlayerUnknown, that's what he said is when, you know, once Smedley went, like, it wasn't a place that he wanted to be doing stuff with anymore. Yeah. It wasn't the same. Like, his allegiance was to Smedley. I mean, not that he said it that directly, but you know what I'm saying? Like, that's where his allegiance was to him. Like, once he was gone, he was like, you guys can keep the game idea. You know, keep making your game, change the name. I'm going to do something else.
Yeah.
Like, I think they went off the deep end.
Exactly. So it's interesting. I hope that he's able to keep hold of the reins, right? I mean, I hope he's able to make the decisions. And I would imagine that he signed a contract that gave him control of this game to make the decisions. And investors that
may have a high percentage, but I think that he...
I'm talking about decision making. I'm not talking about property. I'm talking about I hope...
I think he has every creative, and that's probably why he put creative director. He has the right to decide what the game feels like and what the game looks like. That's what that role says to me. And when they have a meeting talking about the game, he's at the head of the table. You know, he's not the one who's making the decisions of, you know, okay, well, this has to be, you know, this programming thing. I want you to do it my way, you know, even though you do this for a living and like that's exactly what you know. I don't think he is trying to turn over those decisions, but I bet you when it comes to creative decisions, he's the one who has the last and final say on it.
Yeah. So without getting into too much, you know, I mean, obviously, as always, we have no inside knowledge of the inner workings, but hopefully that's the case.
Yeah. I mean, he told us he wasn't going to be doing any ridiculous skins like H1Z1. So, you know, I take him for his word on that.
Yeah.
Until someone proves me wrong.
Yeah, which I hope we don't get proved wrong, but you know, you never know.
Well, and then, yeah, so we'll see. So, do we want to announce the game giveaway now and then?
Sure. What do we got?
Go into some H1Z1 news. All right. So this, let me go ahead and set up the code here. So this is going to be !! giveaway. We'll do it for 30 points. Make sure I spell it right. And this is going to be for Super Brothers Sword and Sorcery. So I think it probably put the text in there correctly at exclamation point giveaway. Sword and Sorcery, I'll put a link to it that you can go check it out. Has good ratings on Steam, kind of a fun game. I'm trying to get rid of some of my smaller games. So if you have a potato for a computer, this should run it.
Where did that yeah.
Where did that term come from? I don't know.
Yeah.
You could remember you could get electricity out of, wasn't it, out of a potato?
You like can get electricity out of a lot of fruits and vegetables, actually.
Yeah. Well, I don't know why they pick potato. There's potato aim, and then you can your computer's can potato. Something about potatoes.
Walmart like connection, you have McDonald's, internet. I mean, it's just a whole.
Yep. So there you go. So yeah, Sword and Sorcery. And we'll do a giveaway here in like 5 or 10 minutes.
PH asks about an Apple computer. Get it?
Ah, yeah. It runs on an Apple. Congratulations.
Which it doesn't, actually, because Intel Core 5000, Intel Iris 5000 is not sufficient enough. All right. Now, I was AFK all week. Tuesday, I uploaded the show. I went to bed. I was up at 6 o'clock for a flight the next morning. I was AFK from Tuesday night until Sunday when I got back.
Yes,
I guess something happened with you on the internet. So
I think Daybreak hates me a little bit more today.
What did you do, Brian? Why did you drag? And of course, I'm associated with this because it's Brian from the Infection Podcast.
Yeah. So, so I was. You know, I've had this conspiracy going on.
You're going all. Let me put. I don't want to be associate. I'm leaving. The so show's in your hands.
I've had this conspiracy of just like these numbers don't make sense to me. I've been looking at the H1Z1 numbers, looking at the growth, and I was like, it just doesn't make sense that in the United States, where I don't see ads on TV, I don't see hype around it in the United States happening, and you know they start teasing me with all these symbols and memes and things. But I kept telling people, it doesn't make sense to me. There's something that's not right about these numbers. And I'm not saying they fake the numbers, but we joke around about that. Yeah, they're faking numbers. They got bots. Yeah. Thank you. Illuminati. And so I decided I want to dig into these numbers and really figure out where they're coming from. So I started analyzing when the growth and peaks of the player numbers are happening. And I mean, right now I'm in school, I'm doing statistics. So I think this is kind of what spurred it, is I'm having to do all these statistics. So I'm looking at the player rates of when peaks of players are, and they're happening at like 8:30 in the morning. My time is when the peak happens, which doesn't make sense for the United States. People don't wake up, especially on school days when people are going to work, wake up and say, I'm going to go play H1Z1, you know, from 3 a.m. till 8 a.m. And so I started looking at the numbers and looking at the statistics on Steam. And if you look, the current players, so the percentage of players during their peaks of the active players in the last 2 weeks, over 30% are from China. So 30% of all players in the past 2 weeks are Chinese. Just barely over 17% are from the US. And then the rest of the numbers add up. So if you take all the other countries that are on the list, those add up to about 30. So, and then there's an other and things like that. But if you look, we keep saying, man, there's a lot of people from China playing. And I put on the post, and it had 85 upvotes, 94% upvoted rating, had up 79 comments on it. And I showed just a graph showing what the player statistics are. So there's the total number of owners. So out of all of the owners, so that's 4.5 million owners, there's 22.17% are from the United States. Only 13.93% of owners of the game, of the 4.5 million, are from China. Yet, of those numbers, the number of players in the past 2 weeks, I broke it down, 75% of the people that have purchased the game in China have played it in the last 2 weeks. I mean, that's of over the however many years, 75% of them have played in the last 2 weeks. That to me is crazy.
So like, do you think
that means that, they had to have purchased it recently. Like these are recent, like this has happened very recently because you see with the other number, look at the United States numbers. There's tons of people that purchase the game that have no interest in playing it anymore. Like they don't play it. It just sits in there, so, you know, in their list.
Is it possible that this game is just very popular in China? And
exactly.
And the same.
So all these numbers that you're seeing spike up is it's China.
Now you're not saying you're not conspiracy theory saying that the numbers are fake. You're just saying
the numbers are fake. I'm just saying that the boom, and I actually tracked it down. So I kept digging down the rabbit hole.
Investigative reporting. This is better than fake news in the United States. This is legit. You're a real reporter.
I'm actually doing much more work than they do in the United States. Yeah. Anyways. So I dug down and I was like, okay, well, what? I went and looked at when the numbers started growing in China. And I just went and searched for what it was that sparked that start. Because these things just, I mean, unless they did some key marketing campaign, right?
Yeah.
Like what would spur that? And so I looked and I found an article that was written in Chinese that said some random post on the internet that some guy made on some random forum that was about how Americans are mad because all these Chinese players are dominating them. And they said that the Americans that they were making comments about how they were dominating the Americans, and the Americans were so devastated that they were learning phrases in Chinese, which probably they got it from some Dr. Disrespect clip. They were learning phrases in Chinese to cuss back at them. And like that post spurred a purchase of hundreds of thousands of Chinese buying the game.
And that's accurate. We were pissed off. We were livid.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And so that one post, for some reason in China, went viral, and it caused hundreds of thousands of Chinese people to buy this game. And now you've seen where it's gone. It's just expanded in China like crazy. We wonder how it went from, 20 to 30,000 concurrent up to 100 and whatever thousand concurrent, 130 to 140,000 concurrent players. It's China. And they're all China. Recent purchases. You'll have the people that did purchase it, you know, that were purchasing it from China and playing. But with the numbers showing that 75% of people have played in the last 2 weeks, these have got to be fairly recent, you know, however, in the last few many months purchases to maintain that kind of a player percentage. So that's the breakdown. And I explained it to people, you know, people ask me questions. People say, oh, you know, you're just saying, you know, whatever. No, I backed everything up with facts. I backed it up with statistics. I showed them and you know, nobody came back to me after this, you know, because you know how Reddit is. I just would say, here's the facts to back up what I put in there. And I would back everything up and, you know, didn't get any incredible hate on it. People said, okay, because that's the truth of it. That is from Steam's API. Those are the numbers of the number of Chinese players. And you can't argue with it. I mean, it's a ridiculous number. China is number one. I put China number one. They weren't lying. They are. They're number one in the number of players in H1Z1 right now. But imagine if Daybreak released some of their numbers. Like how many servers, how many players are playing in China? How many of these players are playing on American servers? They have the ability now to say, all right, you can no longer play on American servers. You have to play on your Chinese servers or your Asia Pacific servers. But based on that article, the main reason they're doing it is because they like the idea of harassing the Americans.
Well, why do you think they release a Call of Duty in China every year? They release, I mean, they have versions of Call of Duty that they release only in China. You can't play anywhere in the world. It's region locked to the Asia region.
So China as well, like because of exchange rates, the game costs, like at its cheapest, it was $5 in China. You could buy the game for $5 in China.
So when people say cheap Chinese keys, they're not kidding.
No, they're $5. They were $5 or $10 right now. The since the election, the value has been the currency has been going back to normal. But right before the election, it was at $5 per copy. And so they could buy copy. I mean, all they have to do is sell some skins, in CSGO? Like, you can get those numbers probably pretty quickly when your value of your of the yen is so much cheaper than the value of the dollar. So, but a lot of these, you know, I heard a lot of comments of, you know, how many of these are people that are hacking? Because we know that the percentage of people that hack in China versus the player base is much higher than the United States.
Oh, for sure. It's a noted
there are American hackers, definitely. But the percentage of Chinese hackers, so how many people are hacking? And this is what I'd like to know. What are the percentage of hackers that are playing H1Z1 versus legitimate players?
So how about this,
Brian?
I bet
you every single match has hackers in it.
So if
I bet you.
According to your chart here, 30% of the active players are from China. Then would it be rash to say that out of that 30%, 20% of them are hackers? Or 15% of them is hackers? Half of the...
I bet you that would be probably accurate.
15 to 20%? I mean, would that...
I think that would be fair. Yeah, I think that would be a fair number.
I mean, if we could see it, you go on Panda TV, the people are just straight up hacking. I mean, it's just...
I was watching one a couple days ago, and it's very common. Like, it's just a part of the gameplay there. That's just kind of the mentality. They do it, and they have no shame on it.
And it's not a problem, but don't let it screw with my gameplay.
If you want, that's the thing. Let me compare this to hockey. If you have two different leagues in hockey, two different, you know, sets of teams and everything, if you go to one league and you don't like the full contact and you feel it's too rough, all right, you have another league that you can go to that's a non-contact league. I'm not, you know, if you don't like contact, go to the non-contact league and play your game. There's nothing wrong with that. But, you know, it's not my job to say, oh, those guys that are full contact, they're, you know, they're just brutes and they're jerks and they're mean. No, like that's the game that they like to play versus there's the no contact league. And that's the game that they like to play. The game that they generally like to play in China is they like to hack. They like to, for them, that's kind of like the challenge. That, you know, see who can do it the best or who can get the right hack. That's not here. Like, that's not the kind of game I like to play. And it's been ruining our experience here. And they're thriving off of that. And Daybreak, I get the feeling that they're not making an attempt to stop it because look at how many sales they're getting off of this. Like, if they actually cut this out, if they segregated them to their own servers and, you know, and they couldn't cross the ocean, they had to play on servers that are in that region. How many less sales would they have? They wouldn't have this 100,000 concurrent players that they're having right now. You know what I'm saying? Like there's no chance. And they're all promoting this. Oh, look at what we got. Look what we got. But you would never catch them spouting these statistics. They're not going to say, oh yeah, they're almost all Chinese. They're not proud of it.
So let me ask you this because it's important. Where did you get this information from, and how did you compile this chart? Because that's always important.
So this is actually directly from Steam Spy, but you have to log in, create an account, and do all this stuff to see these statistics. So they're actually pulling from the Steam API.
So is there a chance that these numbers aren't 100% accurate? Because Steam Spy 100%. Accurate with all the information?
Only if people are putting that their location was in China when they really weren't.
Okay. So, which I doubt
if they're going to buy something with a credit card, they have to have the right country in there.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, that's a thing on Steam because I've tried doing that and it's screwed my account.
You know what I'm saying? Like, it kind of forces you, even though you don't realize it, if you're going to buy anything, it could be some of those others. Could even be people that just don't, you know, they've used PayPal or something and they don't have a realistic number in there.
Gotcha.
You know, so there it could even be a little bit higher, but 30% is the number of in their address field they have China as their address for their billing address.
Okay. So how did you compile
it should be pretty close. So if you go to Steam Spy, and so you can watch this, you know, as you go. So you go to Steam Spy, find the app, you have to create an account, and then under there it is geography. So you'll have to log in. You can look at geography and it will show you this exact graph. And I just had never created an account to see, hey, there's this information here. You know, but it was right out in the open. And I was like, okay, this is crazy. Like, I didn't even realize that this was available, and I've never seen anyone else talk about it. And Joe's asking, you know, PH is asking, could this be VPNs? It shouldn't matter. They would have to have an American billing address.
Well, that's what I typed back in chat. I would assume this information is based on what Steam store they bought it on, because there's a Steam store for different regions.
The thing is, for them to do a purchase with a credit card, they have to put an address in there. So it's going to force them to put that as an address.
Yeah. They'd have to have an American credit card that was shipped over to China.
Very unlikely.
It's not millions of people aren't doing this.
So this should be pretty accurate. Like, it's not going to be far off. They said, and I actually put in there, they have in there how accurate are these numbers, and they gave a percentage range of, you know, what it's possible error range is, and it's not very much. Yeah, it could be G2A sales. Like, there's things that could be in there. But this is of the number of people that own the game, not based off of 100 purchases. But if, let's say, they bought every single game they have and they never purchased a game from Steam, that would be one of the times when they would maybe fit under other.
Gotcha.
Which there are probably some hack accounts that bought all their keys from G2A that maybe not don't have an address in there, and they would fall under other. But that number is 6.75%. So it would be nothing but adding to that 30%.
And what did you use to compile all this data?
This is how it shows it exactly in Steam Spy.
So you didn't build this chart?
I didn't touch it at all.
Oh, I thought you had to build this chart.
To show people what it is. So there's no bias. I just said it. You can go look it up for yourself.
Oh, I thought you built this chart.
No. Oh, I just found it.
I thought you put a whole lot of work into this,
no,
like, this chart.
I looked at this, and so I started digging in, like, when did this happen and why?
Huh.
No, this is just purely statistics. It's just the numbers directly from Steam Spy.
Wow. Okay. Well, then I shouldn't give you as much credit as I did. I thought you put, like, a whole chart together and everything.
Like, why has nobody even mentioned this? Like, how has nobody seen this?
And what was the reaction that you got on Reddit? Because you said this was the front page of King of the Kill subreddit all day?
For the whole day.
Huh?
You know, people saying, what does the owners and players mean? So I just broke down the numbers. But a lot of support. I mean, 94% upvote on Reddit.
On the H1Z1 subreddit, nevertheless.
On the H1Z1 subreddit.
It's pretty good.
You know?
So...
That shows you that there was a lot more support. It's because it's very difficult to get that amount of upvotes on that Reddit, on subreddit.
So then, I mean, what's the next step? I mean, so this explains the numbers. This is why.
I just wanted to know why the numbers, and this explains the numbers.
So that's
this
that.
Is it. I mean, that's the answer. Like, we've speculated. People say, oh, Illuminati conspiracy. No, this is it. And I was mostly right. Like, I was figuring, man, they either making up the numbers or it's a bunch of people from China is what I kept saying. And I was like, I can't, you know, I'm not going to accuse them of making up the numbers, but it doesn't make sense. And yeah, Illuminati. Thanks, Nick.
No problem. Highest production quality on the net.
But you know what I'm saying? Like, that's.
Check this out.
That's it. Like, thanks. For the people that are listening, he's putting Illuminati symbol over my head and spinning it around. So thank you very much. But yeah, so I just figured that's an interesting topic because, thank you, Nick's having fun.
All right.
It created an uproar, but my thing is, now that people know, like, what are people going to do about it? Is it going to make people be like, I'm done playing this game?
Well, but hold on. Why would people stop playing this game?
Because they realize that they're playing against a bunch of people with bad ping rates that have a higher percentage of hackers.
Okay, so they're introducing that ping rate. That actually should be live this week.
Yes. So that's the thing, is holding Daybreak accountable for it. So, okay, they put in the ping rate restriction.
Yep.
And now they just need to, I mean, it's not like we say, no, now they need to fix the hacking. It's been a problem for years now. I don't know that that's going to change.
So,
but, you know, ping is a start.
So ping is the start. So now the question will be, I mean, here's the thing. You already knew people were hacking in H1Z1. This doesn't tell you anything more than you already knew. It just, it doesn't tell you anything more. You already knew that it was a majority of people playing this game were from China and that they were hacking. I mean, we already knew that. We knew that months ago. So I guess my question to you, Brian, is now that this is out there, what does this mean? I mean, does this chart, and I'm not like saying, oh, this was a waste of time. But what will this change for people? Because we already know that the Chinese hack. Well, go on Panda TV, you can see it. They've got the shit on their screen.
I think on Reddit, a lot of people were like, "Oh, you're just blaming China." They thought of it as a joke when people would say it's China. China's doing all this stuff. China. People would go play a YouTube clip. China.
I was going to, and I thought that would have been too much. I had it. I got it ready to. It's queued up. I just didn't.
I know.
You know me too well.
And that's the thing is that. Daybreak is the only one who can answer this. Like, Daybreak needs to start figuring out how they're going to deal with this because they're making the experience in America less fun. And are they willing to have the primary audience of this game be China? I mean, is that fine with them? I think they are because for them, it's about money. And there's a lot of people in China to buy this game. I think that they're going to continue catering to it. Because I think they've sold what they're going to mostly sell in the United States. I think it's hit its peak. But in China, where Battlegrounds is probably going to make them play on their own servers.
They have Asia servers for Battlegrounds. They didn't have that during the test. They have it now that it's live.
And I think that with Battlegrounds, they're going to have stricter anti-cheat. You're not going to be able to speed hack. You're not going to be able to do all these things. I think for them, like, they're not going to have strong China numbers, which Daybreak didn't have strong China numbers until, I mean, there were plenty of people that were playing from China, but it wasn't strong China numbers until like January of this year, February is when it really kicked in. So I think for them, they're looking at it and they haven't tried to deal with it and they haven't even said a word about it. Because why wouldn't they say, hey, in China, we're number one? Why wouldn't they say that? Like, wouldn't a company be proud? In China, we are number one, like one of the top games.
Yeah.
They're saying the numbers, but they're ashamed to say that part. And it's because that's not really something that a video game company wants to be known for, as being the top game in China.
Yeah. Well, I guess we'll have to see. I don't know. I mean, as long as they're legit players, which from all accounts, they appear to be.
Yeah.
I mean, that's it. That is that.
The numbers are real. From what I can tell, the numbers are real.
Yeah.
So, yeah, we'll see.
I appreciate you doing some of that research because
anything's going to change. And, this is just things to accept.
Yeah. And that's kind of my point was we already knew this stuff was going on. It really hasn't. I don't know. It really hasn't changed anything. I mean, what is Daybreak going to say? Ban everybody from China? I mean,
And they don't even have to acknowledge it.
No, there's nothing to acknowledge. I mean, it is what it is. There's a whole bunch of people from China playing the game. We'll see. Maybe this new restriction ping lock is going to stop some of that.
And I think it caught them by surprise as well.
I'm sure it did, but I mean, I wouldn't be complaining if I were them. If you had a game and you had 100,000.
They're making millions of dollars off of this.
Every day you had 100,000 people playing your game. I don't think you'd complain about it either. I mean,
their big goal is to be the top on Twitch, which has gone away, but also they want to have those concurrent players. If you look at their numbers of people viewing in the United States, the numbers are really low.
Yeah. Well, here's the other thing too, Brian, to keep in mind. I think people are saying, well, Daybreak this, Daybreak that. Daybreak can't control who buys the game. All of a sudden...
They're not going to say, don't buy the game in China. You're ruining our reputation.
Yeah. If 5 million people in China want to buy the game, Daybreak, any company with any sense, logical sense, is not going to say, oh, no, please, not all these copies of my game. So... Yeah.
But they need to tailor their servers and make it so that the experience is China's experience and America has their experience and Europe has their experience that isn't affected by the horrible net code. Which is the problem. The people that have horrible, they're playing with a horrible net code, have a better experience. You know, people with high ping rates, they're able to not get shot and to make shots that they shouldn't.
Yeah.
So that's my biggest complaint in the whole thing.
All right.
Is I don't feel like it makes it to where I can't compete. And I think these streamers are seeing, man, we're playing on this other game. And like, it's totally based on skill now. Yes. There's a little bit of luck in it. But it's skill-based, and that's what they want.
Gotcha. All right, let's do this game. Let's do the game giveaway here, and then we've got a quick video to play.
All right. So, Bogey 14. Thank you very much. And I will send you a key here. Actually, yeah, it's a Steam key. And we'll get you a copy of that.
All right. Very so good. Next, we've got an interesting video here. This is an H1Z1 producer's video.
Yes.
That goes through...
From Wynn himself.
Yep. And this goes through some of the test server stuff that we've been talking about for a couple weeks and that you should hopefully be seeing in the future.
Hi, everyone. I'm Chris Wynn, executive producer of H1Z1. Today, we wanted to take a minute to talk about the latest content update that recently hit our test servers. We're really excited about the features that were included in this update, and I know you are all very eager to check them out and see them for yourselves. Let's jump straight into the first feature that is something the community has been looking for quite some time now, and that's Team Follow Cam. So now playing in team games, whether you're playing in duos and fives, and you get eliminated from the match earlier than the rest of your team, you have the ability to stay there and follow them with the new Team Follow Cam. You'll see that you have a UI that tells you all the information that you need on your team, what their current health levels are and stats on the match. You also have the ability at the top of the screen to see who you're currently following and switch between different teammates. Maybe you want to see one perspective over another, and that gives you that ability to do that. The next feature to take a look at are some changes we're making to the vehicles. The goal of these changes are to reduce the number of vehicles that are left at the end of a match. So the first change you'll notice right away is that there's a brand new HUD element for your vehicle. It'll show you how much fuel is there, how much health the vehicle has, what speed you're going, and your car's performance will degrade as you take damage during the match. You'll see this on the new HUD indicated in the lights that flash to let you know which parts of the car are being affected at that time. Take enough damage and you'll even lose your turbo. Okay, so let's take a look at the changes we've made to hit feedback. Let's start off by looking at what happens now when you're engaged with a target that has armor or you have armor on yourself. A few changes here, the first one being that we changed the color of the hit marker to yellow. That's just to make it a lot more clear that you've hit an armored target. We've also changed the audio effect to make that stand out a little bit more so that you catch it in the middle of a gunfight. And then finally, the final change there for armor is that is a much more distinct effect when your armor gets broken. Again, that change being made so that you can notice it during the heat of combat. Also, more clarity around vehicles. If you're engaged with a gunfight with someone in a vehicle, if your bullet strikes that vehicle, you'll notice the hit marker is white instead of yellow for armor or red for flesh. And you'll also hear a new audio effect to make sure that that is much more clear to you. When it comes to engaging with targets who aren't wearing armor, so just good old-fashioned flesh targets, you'll notice that the color of the hit marker stays the same, it's red. The blood splatter that comes off of your body is now directional. This can mean life or death in the middle of a gun battle when you have to react very quickly, knowing where your opponent is and being able to get in a position to engage him. So that about wraps it up. You can go jump on our test servers right now and see all those features for yourself, plus a few others that I talked about in my last producer's letter. Your feedback and your opinions are really important to us, so please hit us up on Twitter or go look for the feedback thread on Reddit and provide your thoughts there. We're really excited to get this update out to live, and I'll see you guys in the game.
First thing off that video, I do find it interesting that now it seems like they're switching back to Reddit, right? We were on Reddit, we left Reddit because Reddit's bad, scary, we don't like feedback on Reddit, now we're back on Reddit. But other than that, I mean, that's a pretty big update, Brian. There was a lot of cool stuff in there. Let's go kind of feature by feature and talk about it. This new, I wish I could show this better. This new HUD here on the screen is pretty cool looking. It shows what?
It's got a lot more information.
Yeah, it shows you know what each player has. It shows their names, what kind of gun they have, if they're speaking. Helmet, body armor. I mean, it shows all that information. That's pretty useful. That's a really nice, useful HUD for team games.
Now, and the one thing is, the big thing I notice is if you look, people have different colors, and this is something we've been asking for a while. Is put different colors on the people's names. Now, if you look, it looks like
I don't think they actually do though.
But look at the names are different, but look, I don't see any difference in the actual name tag.
There isn't. Oh, that's the only thing that's
funny. Now, what about the color of the, look at the one person's pink. Like, why doesn't the outline of the person match their color on the name tag?
Yeah, I'm not.
I mean, I just, maybe they will. Maybe they just haven't.
I think pink is friendly.
Personally, they rushed this out because they were like, oh no, like we need to put out some of these features.
Possibly.
But that seems to be. you know, why is one person purple and the other's not? Like, that just doesn't make any sense. I'm assuming that eventually your outline color will match your player's name tag color. I think they just rushed it out and they haven't completed it yet because they needed to get something out in front of the players.
Yeah. And the next thing I noticed as well is this HUD seems a little big, as well as the vehicle HUD, which we'll see here, is just way too big.
Now he did put out a post with a new one that's smaller that they're saying, oh, this is probably going to be closer. And they shrunk it down a little bit.
Because the HUD is just way too big at the bottom of the screen. And it's on the left-hand side, it's way too big as well. It is nice to be able to use that kind of peripheral vision that you essentially get on the left and right-hand side of the screen to see around walls and stuff like that. So,
you don't want it covering up your vision. Now, what do you think about these hit markers? Did you notice that?
Yeah, I do. We
had some jokes going in Discord about this of like, you know, they need to have like the old Batman, you know, pow, zing, zap. You know, this is what I get from it. I think it's way overboard. Like, they could have done something much more subtle. I don't know why they need to. It's the arcadey feel. Like, it's taking inches of just unneeded. Even if it was a little small one right next to your reticle, like why couldn't you do that? Like, it's just big.
Yeah.
I understand they want to have something different, but it feels so arcadey to me, just how big those are.
It is.
Yeah. PH says everything is too big and way overboard in this game for some reason. And that's kind of, do you think that's on purpose?
I think part of it is we have to remember what we are, what we're looking at. We're looking at an arcadey game.
Now, yeah.
Yeah, and if it's arcadey. I mean, those effects are arcadey, which is, I think, what they're going for. So, is it a bad thing? No, I don't think so.
I mean, I put in, like, an animated GIF of they need to have, like, you know, the slot machine money flying out. Ching, 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 every time you hit somebody. And, like, that's where it's going slowly. Like, what else are they going to put on there? When you do a hit, it'll say epic, you know, epic shot.
Yeah.
Like, you'll just have all these stupid things coming in. Like, that's the next step. Really? I mean, do you not think so? Like, the next step is them now saying how good of a shot it is and having something flash on the screen. Like, they can't go much farther without hitting that. They may do it in a different way. They may have some symbol or something like an achievement you win in game, but it's just pretty much turning in. It's like they're aiming for Call of Duty.
Yeah.
Is what it feels like. So, I mean, I don't want to be too hard on them. I want it to be accurate, but it really feels overboard. And I feel like it wasn't finished, but they feel like they have to put it out now because a company that's been making a game for less than a year came out with something that's right, just about on par with them.
I don't know.
They have?
It's
they've been working on this game for over 2 years.
Yeah. We will. I don't. We'll have to see.
I don't want to depress you or anything.
Well, that's the thing just... is, I'm just. I don't know where to go from here. These features are really cool, but these are features we needed a year and a half ago. This isn't anything game changing. This is my issue with the game.
Follow cam is nice.
Yeah, you know, but Brian,
it should have been a year ago.
September of last year, we were told we were going to have to follow cam. September of last year, or October of last year, after the Invitational at TwitchCon, we were told follow cam was coming into the game. Follow cam is still not in the live game.
Yeah. Here's what I would like answer of why it wasn't put in the game. Even if it's a technical answer, even if they say they need to admit, okay, maybe there was an issue with our engine and we had to rework or something. If that's the answer, I just would like to hear it. Like, but I'm afraid the answer is we just figured it didn't really matter because people were going to keep playing our game and buying it regardless. You know, I mean, honestly, it's not really a priority if it's not going to make them an instant dollar. I think that's what it is. It may have been because it was difficult to do as well, but really it shouldn't have been that difficult. It's not that difficult of a concept. There's no excuse, really, unless other than them just not feeling like doing it or not wanting to put the man hours on to do it.
Yeah. So, I don't know. If this would have been introduced a year ago, I would have been jumping for joy. But it's just,
It would have made a seamless transition of people wanting to stream it. Right now, group streaming this game is horrible because you sit there and you wait 15 minutes possibly after someone dies. Yeah. You die, you have to wait 15 minutes for them to either finish the game or to die. And then that's horrible for streaming. They haven't put out leaderboards anyways for streaming, which is for two-player, four-player games, whatever. They haven't put out the leaderboards for that anyways.
Yeah.
Like, for them, it's not a priority, so they're not doing it. Well, they're making plenty of money. They can hire the people to do it. Like, why aren't they not doing it?
Yeah.
Like, what is stopping them from doing it? They are making the money to do it. Hand over fist, they're making money.
Exactly. So,
there's zero excuses. Like, you could hire.
No, there's not. That's my problem. There is no excuse. That's what it comes down to for me. These are cool things, but there's no excuse why they weren't already in the game. These should have been done. Yeah. There's nothing more to say.
Yeah. I just, that's the thing. It's frustrating. It's just.
And how long till it's live? It's still not live. It's on the freaking test servers.
Yeah. All right, so let's move. We want to move on to Just Survive. We'll cover some of that stuff quick.
Now, by the way, I do think Just Survive is what's going to bring H1Z1 back to life.
Exactly. That's exactly what I was going to say. I do still have hope in Just Survive.
I'm sorry, I didn't mean to steal your thunder.
No, you're not stealing my thunder. But that's exactly what I was thinking as well. Is I feel like these guys now feel of themselves as different from the other team. I just really hope that they don't get pulled into the same mindset if they release and start getting being that part as being successful again. I think them being the underdog right now is good because I think they kind of probably look at the other team and just like, what are they doing? You know what I'm saying? Like, they've got this big team. These guys are kind of coming from behind, and you know, these are guys that came from, most of them now have come from big development companies. Like, these guys know what they're doing. They know what they're supposed to do. And I think they're trying to fix a big mess at the moment. You know, I mean, I you can't really argue that. Like, these guys came in and they inherited a huge mess.
Oh, for sure. So yeah, without a doubt.
That's where I think that for them, a lot of the stuff, it may feel like they're not really getting anywhere. So I think they said, hey, you know, there's a lot of guys that, well, we fix all these problems, you know, remake the map. Like, we got time to do it. Like, they're remaking the map. They're remaking the base building system. But this is the kind of thing that should have been happening the whole time. It shouldn't be we're focusing on one thing, you know, like a dog sees a treat and he only focuses on that one thing. They should have never done that in the first place. And I think that now they've got people making a map. They've got people working. I think they've got people working in areas to where everything is going to come together kind of all at once. When we've been just used to a few things here being trickled in. So hopefully this works out. But so they've got some things that they're reworking the melee system so that combat works correctly with the big reason for this is because when you're fighting a zombie and it takes 20 hits to kill a zombie, that's a problem. You need to be able to farm zombies or have consistent melee when trying to stop a horde from attacking you. And this will also probably allow them to bring in more zombies into the game. Another thing they did is they added weather back in. So I'm really interested to see this. I kind of want to wait for it to go to live. I don't want to install the test server again really that much. But they did put weather back in. And so they did updated particle effects and weather scheduling. So you'll have rain, fog, and then snow is going to be coming in later. They don't have the snow finished yet. So that's something to look forward to. And then also, you know, they just fixed a lot of issues. Now they put a list of their known bugs, which is good. Like, they should put in there, here's bugs that we're working on at this moment. A lot of them have to do with melee because they are totally reworking that system. So this stuff is all on test. And so if you want to go see these things, I saw a screenshot and it looks pretty nice with the new weather system. But if you want to see this stuff, it was March 23rd. It came out. It's on test right now. It gives you an opportunity to play it, maybe find bugs, report them, and try it out. So
there you go. Yeah.
So that's pretty much what they've got right now. But I mean, they didn't put a lot of emphasis on it, but I mean, putting in the weather system is pretty big. redoing the whole melee system. That's pretty big. So hopefully they just keep progress going to where it feels like a fresh game. And I really hope they go through and redo the map and the base building and put it all into one big release. Because I think that's the kind of kick in the pants that it's going to take to get all those people that bought this game to log back in at the same time again.
For sure. Yeah, without a doubt.
So. All right. Okay, so Ark. Well, let's go into Ark because
okay, what do we got
this
for
is actually going to be pretty short.
Ark has been very skimpy with updates recently.
So that's the thing is...
What's next?
They're winding down, I think. I think they're getting into bug fix. Let's just finish it
up. What is there
left
to do?
The game is just... It's crazy as it is. It's got tons of stuff.
Yeah.
So 255.62, this was put out March 22nd. There was two things on it. Fixed a possible dupe case and fixed a server crash with explosives. So it's 255.62 and then 255.7. This was two things. Potentially fixed a case of disappearing dinos. It's not retroactive. And then they added a tribe log. Added tribe log when a dino starves to death. Says going forward, be sure to look for this if your dino isn't around. So that way you can actually know if your dino starved to death and it's not like somebody took it or it's missing.
So that's
it for the past week. Really.
And we're on and we're done.
Patches in the past 2 weeks.
Yeah.
And now tomorrow, now they moved it out 2 days now. Earlier today, it was supposed to be tomorrow. Now it's on the 30th. But they're adding in aquatic and amphibious creature breeding. They're adding in four new creatures. I call them creatures because they're not always dinosaurs. They added new structures. I'm not going to click the picture yet until I finish this. They are adding new underwater tech bases, which I heard this is going to be game changing. So this is going to be a big feature.
Yeah.
They're adding the new tech teleporter, tech Mosa saddle, tech power generator, and they're redoing the UI. So for the inventory, so the inventory is getting, the menu is getting a redesign and it says other UI coming soon. So they're going to be totally reworking the UI, which is great. It looks a lot better. I'll have a screenshot that you can show here in a second. The flyer nerf. So they're nerfing flyers. Another hairstyle, a new facial hairstyle is being added for male and females. 20 plus new explorer notes, new and updated sounds. So they're going through and totally reworking all the sounds. And this is another sign that they're considering it done. Like they're doing their final pass on sounds.
Yeah. So, I mean, that's literally the last thing you do.
You know everything that you're going to have in the game, you go and make sounds for them.
When you're tidying up MP3 files, you know that you've got nothing left. There's nothing else to do. That is some of the.
Now there's a screenshot that shows the new UI. I don't know if you want to click that and see how big it can get. But this looks much better. Fits the theme of the whole Ark thing.
Here. This is as big as I can blow it up.
So it looks much cleaner.
It looks very techy, though. How is this going to work I feel like it's a little too high tech.
That's the thing is, this is high tech.
Yeah, but this guy right now is not high tech. This guy has got just all the. This
but
guy's
the whole
got
theme
nothing.
Of you being dropped down, like that's the thing that surrounds the Ark, that skin that's on the back of that.
Yeah,
that's the dome.
Hmm.
This whole thing is like Ark is high tech. That's the crazy thing is we
spaceships.
Thought it was a dinosaur.
Yeah. I like this UI though.
Yeah, it's much better, and they're going to do that to the whole thing. It's just, and you can see the tabs along the top, so you can see your inventory, and then you'll be able to go to players, and like they're adding additional things, a map, your dinosaurs, like they're adding more things to it that you can't see in the screenshot, but definitely a better, easier to see system. And look at the thing for like when you're adding points at the bottom. Like your melee damage, your movement speed, you hit plus there and you know exactly what you're raising up. You're like, okay, I want to raise my crafting speed. I want to raise my fortitude. A much better system.
Yeah, for sure.
So we'll see. I think that in the next couple of months, I think it's going to be pretty much wrapped up.
Yeah.
And I can imagine, as you said, other than mods coming out, I think they're going to consider it. And then they won't get people hating on them for selling something else and be like, oh, you're selling you know, an add-on for a alpha game.
Yeah.
That we saw.
Which is typically what people do.
All right, man, we're
Running super late.
We didn't cover notes.
This is becoming a real problem. 2 hours is the max. We're not doing any more than 2 hours.
I know.
It takes me too long to upload.
It's crazy that we can't finish. We can't finish in 2 hours anymore. I think we talk too much.
This is the problem. We should just stick to the notes, nothing else. People seem to be enjoying the show. There's a whole bunch of people watching live, a whole bunch of people in chat. And by the way, if you're not in chat and you're not watching this live, we are live every Tuesday, 7 p.m. Eastern, here on our Twitch channel, twitch.tv/infectionpodcast. Tune in live, hang out in the chat, win some games, and you're missing like great pictures that PHVCK are posting.
Now, that's one thing I really want to encourage people. If you're listening to this, like the thing is if you're listening to this out on the pod in a podcast forum, like we don't know who you are. You know, that's the thing is like you need to introduce yourself. And I would encourage you to come join our Steam group. We've had a lot of people come join our Discord, and it's a lot of fun hanging out with people. Once in a while, we'll have somebody says, "Hey, I've listened to your podcast." You know, and I'm just coming by and saying hi. Like, I really encourage that, because that's the thing is when you're downloading it, we see a number, and
you're nothing more than a number to us.
And I'm not trying to make that come across wrong, but you know what I'm saying?
Like a bank.
you're a number and a statistic. And until you come in and you join our Steam group, and even, you know, on Twitch, where you can respond to things that are on Twitter, you can respond to things that we tweet, whatever it is. Like, I encourage you to come out of the shadows and actually, you know, just kind of join, you know, because I don't know of anyone that's joined our group and said, "Oh man, I regret that." Like, usually people really enjoy it. And so if you're out there and you're one of those people that are like, "Yeah, I've listened and I've never like made a step to go and do that next thing of like jumping in the Discord," it's a very casual group. You know, if you're not used to being on a mic, you don't have to be in front of a camera. You know, it's
you prefer you not to be.
People. Yeah, it just relax and, you know, come out and play some games. I really encourage people, because we've got a lot of people that download the podcast, a lot more than that are in our Discord. And so I really encourage you just get in there and you know, take that step. Discord's free. It's real easy to do. You can close it down when you're not using it. But I think it'll really enhance your enjoyment of games if you come out and join. It's just something I think about. It's like there's all these people out there that are listening that they don't come in there, and like I think they would get a lot more out of this.
Yeah, coming in. Once in a while, somebody does pop their head into Discord that's a new name, and they say, "Hey, I'm from the stream or something." Actually, we had a guy a couple weeks ago that came in from PAX. It's like, "Hey, yeah, I got something from you at PAX." Which was pretty cool.
Yeah, so like Donnie PC says, "Yes, they're so right. I'm so glad I watched the show. I listened to it for a long time on a podcast, but I didn't fully appreciate the show for all the hard work you guys do until I regularly sat down and watched it." So I just really encourage you to just take that extra step, because it's really easy to sit there and listen, you know, and because I have a lot of podcasts that I'm like that with. But it seems like there's always, you know, like you don't really, like, "I'm going to go and talk to those guys," or "I'm going to go and play games with these people." That's not how you view the podcast, but that's the thing is that's not how this is. You could come and play like with our group. It's a totally fun group to play with, and I'm encouraging you to do it. And you know, just don't have to sit there and have it be a podcast that you listen to each week.
Brian sounds like an overly attached girlfriend at this point. Just join our group. Please join our group. We're really friendly.
I don't know how else to say it. Like, it's just it's that number, you know. I mean, or says the number. It's just that basic of. It's that easy. Just do it.
Just do it. Thanks, Nike.
Thanks. Yeah, that's my catchphrase of the week. All right. Anyways,
catchphrase of the week. I would pay big money.
Last time I said keep it salty.
I don't know what the hell you're talking about at this point.
It was in PH. Really like that one.
Yeah, we have way too much fun on the show, for sure.
All right. Let me announce the last giveaway so that we can, because we're running out of time. And for the last one, Bogey, I'll send it to you after. It's not letting me send you a message right now, so I'll send it to you after the show is done. I just don't want to have it show up in our chat or anything kind of weird for the key. So All right, so we're doing exclamation point giveaway. Same thing, 30 points. That seems to be adding the numbers up correctly this week, so you should have enough points. Exclamation point giveaway. And we're going to be giving away a copy of Fez. So this,
oh, cool.
Yeah, it's a fun game. I've had it for a while. It's a nice kind of arcadey platformer. But if you want to check it out, put a link for it for its Steam page. It's got very positive ratings. It's a very fun game. It's got a really unique kind of a 3D. It's somewhat of a puzzle game. It's like a platformer puzzle game. But one thing is you're playing the game, like you can actually rotate the world and it's 3D. Platformer indie puzzle exploration casual.
It's very positive on Steam. MPH every week. That's how you describe every game that we give away. That's very positive on Steam, which is the truth. I
just, it's legitimate. Like okay, let's go. We'll look at some other games and they're not very positive. I'll try to find something else positive about. I'm giving away free games. I gotta upsell it.
Oh yeah, because you really need to upsell the internet more on free stuff. It's a real hard sell for the internet.
Please take something for free. It's 91 on Metacritic, since that's all that matters.
Yeah. What's the IGN score? How about that?
I don't have that one. Sorry. Well,
that's the only one I'm interested in. All right. So we're about
like $10 right now. So it's a $10 game for free.
All right. Nothing so let's roll into current players. I got a shortened current players here, and then we'll wrap it up with tip of the week. Does that sound good?
Sounds good.
All right. So without further ado, I'm actually going to have my sound effects back. Here we go. Current players. Currently playing H1Z1. This is Just Survive and King of the Kill combined. 29,380. The 25 peak for these games. 114,088. And a 70 peak. 127,464. How about Just Survive? Low numbers playing this. Currently playing at 2,427. 24-hour peak of 4,960 with a 7-day peak of 5,907. King of the Kill, currently playing that, 26,953. They previously had 109,128. That was their 24-hour peak with a 7-day of 121,557. That is a lot of freaking players. Ark?
Yes.
Brian, not doing so hot in the past couple of weeks. Currently playing at 30,799. The 24-hour peak, 49,453. With a 70 peak, 64,482. And everybody's favorite, Player Unknown's Battlegrounds. Currently playing that, 44,569. 58,416 is your 24-hour peak with a 7-day, 67,718. So just a couple short of 100,000 there, but that's current players. And man,
numbers are kind of skewed now. Like we look at that and say, oh, that looks no. Remember 49,000? That was like not bad.
Yeah, like, I'm surprised
we didn't think anything of it.
What's going on with Ark?
The thing is, what was their numbers a couple months ago? It wasn't that much higher than that.
Who, Ark?
Yeah, they weren't at 100,000. I think that number has, they are like, low skewed. Actually,
no, this is a 3-month peak. They're on the trend down.
Yeah, but it's still not that far off.
They're right where they were, 49,000.
Yeah, they hit 100,000 for.
They're
a
right
bit.
Where they were in December. I mean, they've been riding.
Okay, but let's say they come out of alpha, and let's say that they really push the mods. Like they have a big opportunity to then grow again. Personally, I think
it's possible.
So I you know, right now they're kind of getting into that. We're winding things down to release, and the numbers will go down because they're not constantly putting out new things, but they're getting ready to do another release tomorrow. So that'll probably, or in the next couple of days, I think that'll probably bring the numbers back up for a while. And then until they release it final, and then they start putting out ridiculous mods that are like new things all over again. I mean, they're not having to release everything. People put out some official mod that does, you know, whatever you want it to do, flying cars. I mean, you can do whatever you want. So, is that going to be enough? I think that'll be enough to bring them in.
Yeah. Well, we'll have to see. But it is interesting, though. I'd say they're on a 3-month low.
Yeah.
They had a strong 3 months. Drop.
It's just a consistent
dwindling
number.
I wouldn't say 30,000 is dwindling, but nevertheless, I mean, it is.
Well, I mean, it's just getting smaller and smaller each week.
Yeah. All right.
But no, it's like, oh, what are they going to do? I mean, they still got 50,000 players.
We're all going to die. Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
All right. So let's go ahead and do a tip of the week. Tip of the week is where I go through and either talk about a specific game or maybe a gaming tip in general. This week, I am going to be talking about PlayerUnknown's Battlegrounds. So this is tip of the week. All right, so the theme of this tip of the week is going the distance. Once in the parachute, there is a technique to get some extra distance. Perhaps you're looking at the map and you're like, I want to go to the far other corner. It can be tough if you land and then are trying to run there. Maybe you try to get a vehicle and drive over there. But if you're wanting to pretty much land on that side of the map, or even if you've just gone into your parachute and done your normal flying to an area and you just need to get a little bit farther in the parachute sequence, there is a tip of just alternating pressing forward. So if let's say your W key is usually what you'll be doing to face forward, you can just press it for 1 second, release it for 1 second. Your character will seem like he's kind of swinging in a fast swing. But what it does is actually makes it so you get farther distance, but maintaining the speed. It makes so you don't drop so quickly and you can get quite a bit of distance out of that. So let's say you want to get to the other side of the map. One thing you can do is immediately after you get out of the plane, you can pull the parachute and you can pretty much coast across most of the map doing that. This may change. We'll see as they put out patches, make changes to the game. They may tweak the parachute some, but currently that does work. So just kind of tap that key. I usually find that you can get about halfway across the map if you fly with the regular parachute, kind of just keeping it pressing forward but looking up. And then at the last part, you can use this method to get about double the distance that you would out of the normal landing sequence. So give it a try. If you find that it works for you, I encourage you to let us know. If you find that it doesn't work for you, give us your opinion. But for me, it seems to be working. And a good comparison is we'll all jump out at the same time in a 4-man group. And I can see where I land versus where they land when they're just pressing forward. And usually, I get about double the distance. So I encourage you to try it out. And if you come up with a better method, let us know.
Well, there you go. Yep. Thank you very much.
All right. So we want to go ahead and roll this. I mean, we're right on time.
Yes, sir.
So, all right. So we will pick the winner. And congratulations, Manstan, which I think is Deacon, as we know him, is Deacon in Discord. He loves it when he gets games. He's going to love this. And it'll run on your computer, so you'll be good to go. So
awesome.
I will send you the key. I may just send it to him. I'll send it into him here once I can figure it out. Now, Green Man's trying to enter the game afterwards. And that's even the wrong code. Sorry, Green Man. Raffle doesn't work.
There you go.
All right. Is there anything else you can think of?
Nope.
I mean, we skipped a lot of things.
We'll get to Conan.
Yeah, we'll catch up with Conan, Unturned, Rust.
We'll do our best.
Rust, Hurt World. We'll get as many as we can in there. So for Game of the Week, we're going to be aiming for Chivalry.
Yes.
If enough people don't have it, we'll probably go to something else. But hopefully enough people saw the message.
Yep.
And they actually picked up their free copy today because it looks like it ended. I think they started it last night and it ended like mid today. So it's probably based on, some European time zone or something.
Well, we'll see. We'll see what happens. But it was free for the last 2 days. So hopefully some people were able to pick it up.
Very good. All right. So if you want to find me at Boise Computer on Twitter, or you're more than welcome to go check out my blog, biteoftech.com. Also, I mean, I pleaded with you earlier. I encourage you to go join our Discord, join our Steam group. And follow us on Twitch. You don't do that. And to find all these things, just go to infectionpodcast.com. All those links are on the right-hand side. It's really easy to do. Only take you a few minutes. So try it now. Thanks.
Try it now.
I mean, that's all you do is go do it now.
Yes.
I mean, if you put it off, you'll forget. Now, one thing. Should I do the Lawbreakers key really quick?
Sure.
All right.
You want to just hold it up to the camera and see if somebody grabs it?
That'd
be kind of cool.
Do we want to do that?
Sure.
Okay. So should we give him a second to enter an interview?
No, just go. Go for it. Go.
Is that centered?
It's completely out of focus. Oh, hold on.
Hold on. Let me pull up the thing. Okay. Okay, I'm going to bring it back. Move forward.
Just hold it still. I'll take a screenshot of it. It's so blurry.
Right. Oh, it cleared.
All right, I got it. We're good.
Okay.
So we'll give away a copy of Lawbreakers here if I can find the screenshot I just took. All right, there it is. All right, so
it cleared up at the last second. There we go.
Yeah, so there is your copy of Lawbreakers if you are interested in it. Sorry if you are watching this on if you're listening to this, but there is a copy of Lawbreakers. Brian and I actually had a chance
too late anyways. So
yeah, Brian and I had a chance to play this, and it was actually really cool. I had a lot of fun with it. It was fast. It was fun. It was really good. There wasn't a whole lot to say about it. I didn't play it enough to give a real recommendation.
Well, okay, so initially I was kind of like, this isn't that great. But then once I figured out the game modes and kind of figured out the characters, like, okay, this is fun. So it might take you a minute to kind of figure it out. But yeah, give it a little bit more opportunity. Cause I think we're so used to Overwatch, which is just feels so seamless and everything's kind of ridiculous. This one, like, you have more normal guns, not so crazy of characters, but I think if you play it enough, you kind of start to understand it a little bit better and it becomes more fun as you go.
It appears the PH redeemed it.
And, I like how you put get good.
Yeah. So, so congratulations, on that. It's a lot of fun. We should definitely play it. You got anything else? You all set?
No, I think, and I may have another key, that maybe they'll give away next week. Because I think I got one emailed to me as well.
Cool.
So maybe we'll do that one next week.
Alrighty. Thank you very much, Brian. Thanks to everybody for tuning in live for another episode of Infection, the Survival Podcast. Of course, if you didn't tune in live and you want to tune in live, we are live every Tuesday, as we always have been, 7 p.m. Eastern on our Twitch channel, twitch.tv/infectionpodcast. Of course, check out our website, infectionpodcast.com, as well. Guys, that is going to do it for another episode of Infection. Thank you for tuning in. Have a great week, and we'll see you next time.